throughout. The polyamine ward fundamental occupied by Davidson Chemical Company, Davidson Chemical Division of the WR Racing Company. It's given to one of our younger scientists for his excellence in fundamental analysis in the 1993 award. He is Professor Mark Barteau. Mark is Professor of Chemical Engineering and Chemistry and Associate Director of the Center for Catalytic Science and Technology at the University of Delaware. He has his PhD from Stanford in 1981, and that dissertation was awarded the Monero Award of the American Chemical Society in 1982, and another certificate award that he's already received is the LMP Coleman Award from the American Institute of Chemical Engineering, which was awarded for excellent publication in 1991. He has shown us some innovative work in surface science and metal oxide that provided us new insights into organic reactions on well-defined oxide surfaces, and it will be some of that work which he's going to review for us this morning, an lecture titled Sites and Syntheses on Oxide Surfaces.
Thank you, Gary. I feel honored and humbled to receive this award and deliver this lecture named for Paul Emmett. I had the good fortune to get to know Professor Emmett while I was a graduate student at Stanford. He made several visits there of about a week in length and spent most of that time meeting one-on-one with graduate students. And I think we sometimes forget just how inspiring those kinds of experiences can be for the students. And certainly I was inspired by his interest, by his insights, and to some of the opportunities coming out of that work, including opportunities for the catalytic synthesis of ketenes, which is a problem we only recently returned to, and by his ability to recall results from his own work from as much as half a century before. So it means a great deal more for having gotten to know the man to be able to give this talk this morning. Projector working out. Go ahead and slide the light switch forward, if you would. I wanted to begin my talk this morning with the quote that Professor Zottler finished with on Monday morning, and that's the quotation that says that if I have seen further, it is by standing on the shoulders of giants. As Henry Petrosky has pointed out, scientists are fond of quoting Sir Isaac Newton in that way, but in fact, that line has been traced as far back as the Roman poet Lucan, 16 centuries before Newton. So I think the message is of the importance and endurance of ideas, even through perhaps a few intervening dark ages. But what I would like to start doing this morning is to acknowledge some of those on whose shoulders I feel that I have stood. In fact, three former Emmett awardees, the first and most important to my career, was Bob Maddox, my advisor at Stanford, and the work coming out of that group demonstrating that oxidation reactions on a silver surface could be described in terms of acid-base models, and further, that one could make, in some cases, quantitative predictions of surface reactivity based on the thermochemistry of dissociation of acids in the gas phase. And I think the citation there is perhaps the first application of gas phase acidities and basicities in the surface science and catalysis literature. While we were doing that work, we were certainly very well aware of the work that the late Professor Kokas had done more than a decade before, looking at acid-base reactions on oxide surfaces and coming up with a very similar picture of what was going on. But the interesting thing was that the thermochemical database that he chose to apply was different, and his observation that aqueous dissociation constants of Brønsted acids seemed to be able to predict their relative reactivities with zinc oxide surface. And so I found that the comparison between those intriguing, that gas phase acidities would apply to one type of material and aqueous acidities to another. And as I began to think about how to delve further into this, some of the work of Harold Kung first began to appear in the literature, demonstrating that one could look at chemical reactions on single crystal oxides in ultra high vacuum and get some meaningful results out of that. And that was really the last bit of motivation that I needed to embark on my own program in this area. One of the very first reactions that we chose to examine was one that the Kokas had done a number of years before that, and that was the adsorption and dissociation of alkynes, and in particular methyl acetylene or propyne, on surfaces of zinc oxide. And the high surface area powder data was somewhat ambiguous. The original work suggested that of the two kinds of protons in this molecule, an acetylenic proton and one on a methyl group, that zinc oxide preferred to abstract a methyl proton and to make what's referred to as a propargyl intermediate on the surface. And subsequent work had suggested that perhaps there was a mixture of both those species and the ones formed by removal of the acetylenic hydrogens. And that's where we began to look at that kind of chemistry on single crystal surfaces of zinc oxide and to compare that with other materials. This is the short summary of that result, some X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy looking at the sorb intermediates formed from methyl acetylene by proton abstraction on a metal surface and on an oxide, zinc oxide. In the case of silver, we could do both titration and isotopic labeling studies to demonstrate clearly that what we formed was the acetylide intermediate by acetylenic proton abstraction on the surface. And we got two carbon signals. There's one central carbon here and the two terminal carbons there. The envelope on zinc oxide was a little broader, but insufficiently broad to include both of those peaks. What it looked like was that we had carbon atoms, all of which were very similar in electron density on the surface, and that led us to conclude, in agreement with the earlier work of Kokas, that what we had were these pi-bonded propargyl intermediates with the resonance structures available to them, which evened out the charge density on those carbons. Now, the reason that that was an interesting reaction to try, I think it's apparent if you go back to the gas phase thermochemistry. If you look at the abstraction of protons from methyl acetylene in the gas phase, removal of the acetylenic proton is favored over removal of the methyl proton by about 6 kilocalories per mole. So it's the acetylenic hydrogen that's the more acidic, and if you're following the gas phase acidities, then it should be the acetylide that you make on the surface, as indeed happens on silver. However, as the bond to the surface becomes less polar, as you approach the limit of radical chemistry, homolytic dissociation, the propargyl intermediate is favored overwhelmingly over the acetylide. Our conclusion was not that we were doing radical chemistry on zinc oxide, but if you allow me to interpolate linearly between those, one only need go about 6/46 of the way in the direction of reducing the charge on the organic anion to make this propargyl intermediate competitive. And so the picture that emerged from this work was indeed that the gas phase acidity supply of silver, we could predict which proton was abstracted based on the gas phase thermochemistry. The bonds of these organic anions to the metal cations on oxides had a somewhat larger covalent contribution. The intermediates on the polar oxides, in fact, formed a less polar bond to the surface. Now, we have, over the years, looked at this kind of question, the nature of the surface adsorbate bond on oxides, but I don't want to spend the time this morning doing physical organic chemistry of that sort. What I want to do is talk about reaction mechanisms for, I think, some very interesting chemistry on oxide surfaces, and to use those to understand the sites that are required of the surface to perform those transformations. And our ability to do that has really hinged on the application of the arsenal of surface science techniques to oxide surface, not just at the metal. And I want to show you one of the first examples of that from our group. And this is early work in the spectra art, perhaps as high a resolution as we now get. But I think this is one of the first examples in literature of using, for example, XPS on an oxide single crystal to track the interconversion of intermediates on the surface. And here we've absorbed methanol intact on one of the surfaces of zinc oxide. It dissociates to form a methoxy species, and there's a carbon 1s shift associated with that. The methoxy gets oxidized to a formate, shown here. You can watch this happening as you warm the surface. The methoxy decomposes first, it disappears first, and then the formate goes away. And the chemistry here isn't particularly exciting. That was well known from previous infrared studies, but I think this is one of the first demonstrations that one could do that kind of thing in a surface science experiment. Today, we almost take that for granted, but I have a favorite quote to remind us that we shouldn't do that. It's been less than a decade since one could suggest with some legitimacy that in fact these kinds of experiments using photoelectron spectroscopies to look at organic intermediates on oxide surfaces was impossible. So a lot's changed in the last 10 years. In fact, I wasn't so certain that this fellow wasn't correct, and so I hedged my bets a little bit and initiated programs on oxide thin films and on metal surfaces just in case this didn't work. Fortunately, it did. Those programs have developed nicely on their own as well, but I won't have time to talk about that this morning. Now, I think there are reasons for tackling this challenge, and they're listed on this slide. I think by doing surface science experiments on single crystals, we can hope to define the surface site requirements for chemical reactions because we have very good control over the sites that are there. And if we can apply the full arsenal of spectroscopic tools, then we can work out many of the reaction mechanisms that are operative on those surfaces. I think there's another important point. Much has been made about drawing analogies with organometallic complexes in solution and applying that chemistry and the mechanisms and the site requirements there to surfaces. That hasn't worked all that well for bare metal surfaces. I hope I can convince you this morning that there are examples where it works extraordinarily well on oxide surfaces. And the critical issue there is the fact that by working with oxides, we can look at metal centers in oxidation states other than zero. We can cycle them between different oxidation states. We can do the things that are crucial to making similar chemistry go in solution. And we can't do that on metals which are restricted to the zero valence state. So I wanted to spend this morning showing you examples of the first two of these and perhaps suggesting to you that from that there are opportunities to perhaps invent new catalysis. We haven't done that yet, but I'll certainly share with you where we think the opportunities lie. The points I want to make this morning are shown here in terms of the surface site requirements. I'm going to show you different reactions on oxide surfaces which require different things of the surface. And they're going to require things like coordinative unsaturation of surface cations, and we'll find activity and selectivity of surface reactions which depends on the coordination environment of the surface cations, on the redox properties of the oxide. I won't emphasize that so much. And then finish with a couple of examples that we've been working on in recent years, some of it really quite new data, demonstrating the connection of some of the reactions we're looking at to the oxidation state of the surface, or in some cases, the oxidation states of individual cations present on the surface. So let's begin with the first of these. That's the role of surface coordinative unsaturation. If one goes back in the literature, one can find this idea expressed by many people in many different ways. The basic idea is that dissociation of Brunstedt acids of the sort that I have shown you already requires a site pair on the surface can describe that as an acid-base cation anion metal oxygen cycle pair, as you wish. All of these are the same, and all of those are really the same. And you can find that in Kokas and Burwell and Hines and on back in the literature. We've examined this kind of idea on single crystal surfaces by using surfaces which do and do not provide these kinds of sites. In particular, we'll look at reactions on the two polar planes of zinc oxide. This one has no coordination vacancies available at its surface cation. This one has one per cation. And we'll see that the reactivity of those is different, and that leads us to the conclusion that the cation involved in this pair must have a vacant coordination site at which we can park the conjugate base anion of the Brønsted acid. Now beyond that, we find that the coordinative unsaturation of these surface cations plays a role in what reactions occur subsequently, and we'll compare the reactivity of two faceted structures of the 001 plane of titania. This one contains surface cations, each of which have one vacancy. This one provides some cations with pairs of vacancies. We'll see the importance of that. Let me begin with the zinc oxide story. And let's start with the structures of zinc oxide. I wish I could tell you that this figure was a product of one of the scanning tunneling microscopes in my laboratory. Unfortunately, we're not quite there yet. It's the product of a graphics workstation. What you see here is a space-filling model of the zinc polar surface of zinc oxide. Here are the zinc cations in the topmost layer of the surface. The oxygen anions are nominally in the plane below. They're coordinated with four zincs. But they are quite accessible to incoming molecules at the surface. The zinc cations each have a single coordination vacancy. The bond that is missing is the one that would be sticking out of the plane of the screen here. That surface is active for dissociating Brønsted acid to attach the organic anions to the zinc cations, and the protons have plenty of room to attach the oxygen anions. If one literally turns the crystal upside down, one exposes the oxygen polar face of the material, and here you see the structure is different. We now have these bulky oxygen anions exposed at the surface. The zinc cations are buried in the plane below. They're fully coordinatively saturated. They're sterically inaccessible, and that surface is essentially dead for the dissociation of Brønsted acid. One can demonstrate that in a number of ways, and with a number of spectroscopies. My favorite is perhaps the least conventional of those, one that we've been working on in recent years, and that's photoluminescence. Zinc oxide is a semiconductor with a band gap in the ultraviolet, and if you excite it with harder ultraviolet radiation, it will luminesce. Will give off ultraviolet radiation corresponding to the band gap energy, and it will also emit light in the visible. And what you have here is a single crystal of zinc oxide being illuminated with an ultraviolet laser, and we're observing in this photograph the visible light being emitted from that crystal. I happen to think the photo is a nice metaphor of how we would like to think about our surface science experiments, these sort of perfect single crystals floating in the void of vacuum. Of course, we all know that there's considerable hardware behind and around these samples that you just can't see. In any case, the light emission from these oxides is sensitive to the adsorption and reaction of organic molecules at the surface. And that's shown here. If we adsorb acetic acid on either of the two polar planes of zinc oxide, there are no zeros shown here, but in fact we approximately double the amount of light that's emitted by luminescence from the bulk material. And as you heat progressively to higher temperature, you either desorb the adsorbates or convert them to other species. Before collecting each of these spectra, we have to cool back room temperature, by the way, because the emission is temperature sensitive. But basically, you can see the difference between these two planes. The oxygen polar plane, as molecular acetic acid adsorbs and simply desorbs at low temperature, luminescence returns fairly quickly to its original value. On the zinc polar plane, we form surface acetates, and they stay on the surface until they thermally decompose at quite high temperatures. So from simply the temperature history of the photoluminescence of the sample after absorption, you can see some reactivity difference between these points. It shows up quite clearly in XPS and UPS as well. I won't show those results. I will show you the temperature program desorption results. This is following absorption of acetic acid on the zinc polar plane. We did this on the oxygen polar plane. We would simply desorb the acid molecules and nothing else would happen. On the zinc polar surface, we make surface acetates. They undergo a thermal decomposition at high temperature to liberate ketene, a net dehydration reaction. There's a decarboxylation to liberate CO2. We deposit surface carbon, and that reacts by extracting oxygens from the lattice of the oxide and burning off as carbon oxides here. In doing that, we reduce the zinc to zinc metal. It doesn't bind very strongly to its oxide, and it comes flying off into the gas phase. It's essentially equivalent to winning a metal from its ore by roasting it with coke. A bit of lore that certainly goes back to ancient times. I think the importance here is demonstrating, again, that these surface reactions can change the oxidation state of a species at the surface, sometimes with rather dramatic consequences. Okay, well, our conclusions from those kinds of studies were that we needed an acid-base site pair on zinc oxide, for example. We needed a vacant coordination site on the cations to activate Brunstedt acids. And the chemistry that we observed for the carboxylates was either decarboxylation to liberate CO2 or a net unimolecular dehydration to ketene. One of the questions is, how generalizable is this to other oxides? And the answer is that it's quite generalizable. We can go to other materials, for example, magnesium oxide. We look at the 1-0-0 plane. Each of the cations on that plane is missing a single bond to an oxygen. We have a single coordination vacancy for surface cation. It also dissociates from the acids. We can get about 2/3 of a monolayer of carboxylates on there. The selectivity of the reaction is a little different. In the case of MgO, we see very high selectivities for dehydration. In case of acetic acid to ketenes, we don't see the decarboxylation chemistry. We can go to other oxides, and I want to spend most of this morning on titanium dioxide. We've worked with the 001 plane, which is a thermally unstable plane, and it rearranges to two different structures, which give us different chemistry. The first one that one forms at about 750 Kelvin is referred to as 011 faceted. And in this case, again, each of the titanium cations is missing a single bond to oxygen out of the plane, single coordination vacancy for surface cation, just like on the MgO and zinc oxide surface trend. As one anneals that surface to higher temperature, it undergoes a more dramatic rearrangement. One now coordinatively saturates some of the titanium cations. They have 6 oxygen neighbors. There's still some with 5, but now we open up some with only 4. So we create surface cation sites with pairs of coordination vacancies. And as I'll show you in a moment, we turn on new chemistry when we do that. That's illustrated for you in summary form here. Let's look at the top part of this. What we do is to ion bombard the single crystal surface, then reduces it and it disorders it. So in a range of temperatures here, we see no electron diffraction. We also see depletion of oxygen. As we anneal the surface, we diffuse oxygen out of the bulk of the material. We restore the surface to essentially a stoichiometric state at fairly modest temperatures. And we create then these two ordered structures, the one with 5-fold coordinated surface cations, and the one with 4, 5, and 6-fold coordinated surface cations. We can do this preparation at a variety of different temperatures, and we can test the chemistry of the surfaces prepared at those temperatures individually, all with one sample in our vacuum system. This summarizes the chemistry of acetic acid on those surfaces for you. On the reduced surface, it doesn't do anything very interesting, and it just gets cleaned up. But as soon as you get to this ordered, oxidized surface, we see a dramatic increase in the selectivity for ketene. It approaches 60 to 70% here. So it begins to look very much like the zinc oxide and the magnesium oxide surfaces that I showed you. We're doing a lot of unimolecular dehydration on these surface cations with a single coordination vacancy. As we prepare the surface in this state and open up titanium sites with pairs of coordination vacancies, we open up a new reaction channel, and that now is a bimolecular reaction channel. We're forming carbon-carbon bonds. We're making, in this case, acetone with three carbons from a reactant acetic acid with two carbons. So we're coupling pairs of carboxylate ligands, and to do that, we require pairs of coordination vacancies on individual phthalates to do that. But basically, to summarize all of this carboxylic acid chemistry, we see a variety of reactions, and they depend on the state of the surface. The decarboxylation versus dehydration selectivity seems to depend on the oxide reducibility. More reducible oxides, like zinc oxide, do more of this. Less reducible ones, like MgO, do less. We get some reduction on reduced sites, but the key issue as far as surface coordination environment is this one. On surface sites with single coordination vacancies, we do chemistry of isolated molecules, unimolecular dehydration. When we can coordinate pairs of carboxylates and a single cation, we can couple them together. And that chemistry goes well beyond acetic acid. One can do that with the propionic, formic acid mix from aldehyde, acrylic acid mix, divinyl ketone, and so on. And the key point is having, again, pairs of coordination vacancies on the surface cation. That chemistry is generalizable to things other than carboxylate coupling. The same thing holds for coupling of alkoxides formed from alcohols. We're used to acid-catalyzed routes to ether formation by protonating alcohols and oxonium ion routes. Here's a route that goes on basic surfaces via proton abstraction from the alcohol to make the alkoxide, and then coupling of pairs of alkoxides to the ethers. But again, that one is sensitive to the surface structure. It occurs only on surfaces which allow pairs of alkoxides to be coordinated to a single surface cation. All of this is really analogous to the site requirement for doing polymerization with titanium-based Ziegler-Natta catalysts. And there one has to have pairs of coordination vacancies on the titanium center, one to bind the growing polymer, one at which to bind the monomer, which then gets inserted into the polymer and reopens the coordination vacancy at which to bring in more monomer. So essentially, the chemistry that we're looking at here is the surface science mimic or analog of polymerization chemistry on titanium-based catalysts. One can extend this to surfaces which are not single crystals to try to test these ideas. And again, titanium gives us a nice opportunity because it forms two different bulk structures, rutile and anatase. The coordination of the surface cations in both of those is the same. It's octahedral. It's the arrangement of the octahedra with respect to each other that's different. And if our hypothesis is correct, that it's the local coordination environment which is determining this chemistry, then we would expect that the selectivities or the activities of these two different bulk structures for these kinds of bimolecular coupling reactions should be quite similar. And this slide shows you the data to test that hypothesis. This is looking at ethanol on powders of anatase and rutile. Here's the dimethyl ether or diethyl ether production from ethanol. You can see that the kinetics are similar, the temperature is about the same. There's some variation in the selectivity of the ether product. However, we did this in a gravimetric device, so we knew the initial coverage of ethanol, and so we could in fact calculate quantitatively the ether yield from this bimolecular coupling reaction on these two different bulk structures, and one has to go to the third decimal place to distinguish a difference. So this is about as insensitive to the bulk structure as I think we could hope to demonstrate, and suggest that our description of what's going on purely in terms of local coordination environment is appropriate. I want to leave the coordination story now and consider a couple of other classes of reactions which form carbon-carbon bonds on titanium oxide surfaces. These are the reductive coupling of carbonyl compounds and the cyclotrimerization of alkynes. What will be important in this story is not the coordination environment of the cations, but their oxidation state. And so before introducing this chemistry to you, I need to tell you a little bit about the variations in oxidation state of the surface and how we control that. That's illustrated on this slide. This is a titanium 2P XPS spectrum. Let's start at the bottom. This is a well-annealed stoichiometric titanium dioxide surface. We see a single line corresponding to titanium 4+. It's quite narrow. There's actually a doublet because of final state splitting, but we don't need to worry about that. As we ion bombard, we disorder and reduce the surface, and in fact, we see considerable broadening and loss of resolution of this envelope. And the reason is that we're removing oxygen preferentially. We're creating titanium centers in oxidation states lower than +4. In fact, we can detect contributions from +3, +2, and +1. As far as we can tell, we never make titanium zero, titanium metal, purely by sputtering, and that will be important in a few moments. We can fit these curves to get the populations of the different cations, different oxidation states, and even if you don't believe those to the third decimal place, at least the trend as one heats the surface is quite clear. This envelope collapses. We are preferentially, we're diffusing oxygen out of the bulk material, and we're losing in sequence the lower oxidation states until by the time we reach 750 Kelvin to produce the ordered structures that I showed you before, we have a fairly stoichiometric surface. Now, the chemistry for the rest of the talk will be on surfaces that look like the top two. As I said, we can quantify the distribution of surface cations, and here's a map of that showing you the relative or the fraction of titanium in the XPS sampling region, the +1, +2, and +3, +4 oxidation states, as a function of the temperature to which we've heated this initially reduced surface. And you can see that the things make sense. We lose the lower oxidation states in essentially a sequential fashion. We lose the +1 first. Some of that's obviously going first to +2 because we see an increase in the population there. It goes away. +3 is the last to go. And by the time we reach 750 Kelvin, we have a nearly stoichiometric surface. We're going to look at the dependence of carbon-carbon bond formation on the oxidation state and the distribution of cations on these surfaces. The first reaction that I'm going to tell you about is this one, referred to as carbonyl metathesis, or reductive dimerization, or reductive coupling, or if you're an organic chemist, perhaps you know it as the McMurray reaction, after the fellow who discovered it about 20 years ago. It is not a catalytic reaction. It's a stoichiometric reaction. It's carried out in liquid solid slurries of titanium chlorides in the presence of a strong reducing agent like lithium aluminum hydride or zinc copper couples. The active site, at least in the organic literature, is proposed to be titanium zero. That's based on some very dicey spectroscopy and mainly stoichiometry. This coupling reaction is a 4-electron reduction. Therefore, you need to do a 4-electron oxidation of the surface. If you insist that happen at a single metal center, then it has to be titanium zero in order to get all the way to titanium +4. I'll comment on what we think about that. The mechanism of this reaction is proposed to involve a surface pinnacylate intermediate. You form a carbon-carbon bond first and then slice the carbon-oxygen bonds. The reason for that is really energetic. Each of these carbon-oxygen double bonds is worth about 175 kilocalories per mole. So a carbene pathway would be very energetic here, and this looks like a low energy path to do that. In spite of the high energies of the bonds we're breaking here, as I'll show you, this chemistry goes at room temperature. It goes on metal oxides in ultra-high vacuum. And some of the first examples that we found of this were things like acetaldehyde, butene, acrolein appears to make hexatriene. The one I want to use to illustrate the point is the coupling of two molecules of benzaldehyde to make stilbene. So here's a 14 carbon atom product that we can make on a single crystal in UHV. And in fact, we can do better than that, as I'll show you. These reactions certainly require us to reduce the surface before exposure to the organic. But as I showed you a few moments ago, we never have titanium metal present. So we don't believe that titanium metal required to do this chemistry. It is certainly very dependent, however, on the oxidation state of the surface. What's shown in the left-hand panel is the production of stilbene from benzaldehyde, and you see as we perform this on surfaces which have been annealed at higher temperatures, the production of stilbene drops dramatically. On the right-hand panel is a somewhat qualitative figure illustrating the population of titanium cations in reduced states relative to plus 4. You can see that the population of reduced sites falls off dramatically between about 600 and 800 Kelvin, and that's precisely the range where the stilbene production is falling off. So I think there's a clear connection between activity for this reaction and these oxidation states present at the surface. The other point I would like to make about this reaction is that it is the dominant reaction on these surfaces. We're not looking at a trace product here, even though we're doing carbon-carbon bond formation in ultra-high vacuum. Here's the fractional yield of products from the adsorption and temperature program desorption of benzaldehyde on one of these reduced surfaces. And you can see that more than half of the carbon adsorbed initially as benzaldehyde leaves the surface as stilbene. If you recognize that the second most abundant species is unreacted benzaldehyde, so divide this by 0.78, you see we're approaching selectivities of about 70% of the benzaldehyde molecules which are converted, get converted to stilbene. So this is not a trace reaction going on some exotic defects. This is the dominant chemistry of these reduced surfaces. I think it dominates in part because it's so easy to do, and we can demonstrate that in a couple of ways. This is the temperature program desorption of benzaldehyde on the reduced surface, and showing you the desorption then of the product still being coming off just above 100 Kelvin, so it comes off at quite low temperatures. By the way, these kinds of experiments are relatively easy to do in terms of product detection, because the products all have higher molecular weights than the reactants, and it's very easy to find something that wasn't there in the starting material. You don't have to do a lot of deconvolution of overlap and fragmentation patterns in your mass spectrometer. The point of this slide, though, is to show you that the evolution of the stilbene is basically governed by the kinetics of its desorption from the surface rather than the kinetics of its formation. If we adsorb this stilbene on the same surface, you see it desorbs at basically the same temperature. So this is desorption limited. The reaction actually takes place at room temperature, and we're just waiting to desorb the stuff in the temperature program desorption experiment. You can tell that it happened at room temperature by doing the X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy. This is showing you the distribution of titanium cations on the initial surface. This is after we simply adsorb benzaldehyde at room temperature, and you see now an increase in the population of titanium cations and higher oxidation states and a depletion of the reduced states on the surface. And that happens just at room temperature. In fact, the total oxygen uptake here corresponds to increasing the average oxidation state of one monolayer of titanium cations by plus one unit. Now, as the previous slide demonstrated, in doing this stoichiometric reaction, we're depositing oxygen on the surface. In order to make this catalytic, as we would like to do, we need a way to reduce the catalyst and return it to its original state. And illustrated here is a hypothetical catalytic cycle for doing this kind of reaction. We start with a reduced oxide material. We might hope to reductively couple these carbonyl compounds. That would leave us with an oxidized surface, which we then might reduce with hydrogen, perhaps with CO, perhaps with another organic molecule to make the catalytic cycle turn over. This is really kind of the reverse of many selective oxidation processes. We have not made this cycle turn over catalytically. What we have done, however, is to demonstrate that we can do the individual steps required in this cycle on high surface area of titanium oxide at atmospheric pressure. So we can hydrogen reduce the catalyst, we can do the reductive coupling, and so forth. We can cycle in a sequential fashion. We have yet to demonstrate that we can do that at steady state, but we're working on it. Let me show you the data illustrating at least the sequential operation We're looking now at a titanium oxide powder oxidized to essentially a stoichiometric state. We're looking at the coupling now. This is a cross-coupling of benzaldehyde with acetaldehyde to make one phenylpropene, again, a product with higher molecular weight than either of the reactants. There are reasons for doing this as a cross-coupling that I don't have time to go into. Basically, the fully oxidized powder is inactive for doing this reaction. The longer and the higher the temperature at which we reduce the sample in hydrogen before we start the reaction, the larger the signal that we get for the reductive coupling product. The chemistry is not unique to titanium. In fact, we've discovered a couple of other oxides that will also do this, including oxides of iron and of ceria, will also do the reductive coupling. And you see the peak temperatures here for the products are in different places. Certainly the reducibility of these oxides is different. And perhaps one of these other oxides is where we should look for the catalyst for this reaction. So let me summarize some of this reductive coupling chemistry. Up until a few years ago, this was strictly a liquid-solid reaction, stoichiometric reaction. The active site was proposed to be titanium zero, and the mechanism was via pinacylate. We've been able to show that you can do this as a gas-solid reaction, still not deadly yet, but we're working on it. You can do it on high surface area oxides. You can do it over a range of pressures that goes from ultra-high vacuum on up. We've been able to show that the individual steps that you need to complete the catalytic cycle can be carried out. They just haven't been done in steady state yet. I think the XPS results show clearly that at least for the gas-solid reaction, we don't require a single titanium zero site. What that says is that we have an ensemble site, that we must have a collection of surface cations which are capable of giving up the four electrons to do this four electron reduction. So we're not doing it with a single site, we're doing it with some ensemble. And the other point is that there are other oxides which show activity for this reaction. We've looked at a variety of these kinds of coupling reactions. I've illustrated some of the ones up here for you. One can go to cyclic ketones. I want to spend the rest of the talk on chemistry motivated at least by these last two reactions. From benzoquinone, we make phenylene oligomers. We can detect biphenyl and terphenyl in the mass spectrometer, and three rings is the limit of our mass spec. We suspect we're making products with more. But there's an 18 carbon atom product assembled on an oxide surface in ultra-high vacuum. In fact, we think we're assembling much more than that. We think we're making polyparaphenylene polymers, straight chain conductive organic wires across the surface. And we're working to try to demonstrate that. I'll show you one enticing result at the very end of the talk. I want to spend the next few minutes, though, on chemistry that's come out of this last reaction. The pinacols or glycols are proposed to be the intermediates in this reductive coupling. And so we said, okay, let's put them into the system and see what they do. And we got a surprise. What we found was that the simplest of those, ethylene glycol, makes benzene, which was not the product that we expected. And the question is, how does this happen? Do you begin to form the carbon-carbon bonds, as in the reductive coupling, before you break the carbon-oxygen bonds? Or do you perhaps dehydrate, double dehydrate this to acetylene, and then trimerize the acetylene? And so we've gone on to examine the cyclotrimerization of acetylenes as a way of looking into this. And indeed, we think that's the mechanism for this reaction now. This is very recent work, but I think it really fleshes out the story of surface site requirements. And so I've taken this opportunity to tell you about it. We've looked at three different alkynes, acetylene, methylacetylene, and 2-butyne, and basically all of those will cyclize on reduced titanium surfaces very effectively. And again, it's easy to detect these products. They've got molecular weights which are three times those of the reactants. I'm going to spend almost the entire remainder of the talk on the chemistry of methylacetylene. So we've come full circle, and we're back to methylacetylene. Here's a temperature-programmed desorption experiment for methylacetylene on a reduced titanium dioxide surface. And the principal product of this reaction, and I'll quantify it for you in a moment, is trimethylbenzene. In fact, these are the raw mass spectrometer signals. Those of you who use mass specs know that the higher the mass, the lower the sensitivity, and yet we see the most abundant mass of all being one corresponding to the trimer. Actually, this happens to be cracking of a methyl group off the trimer, but it's assignable to the trimeric product. We see a little bit of the unreacted alkyne, we see a small amount of hydrogenation to propylene, and we see a small amount of dimerization to the C6 product here. We've drawn these dashed lines. There's one methyl group in either of these two positions and one methyl in either of those two. We don't know what isomers of the butyne that we're making. We do know, and I'll show you in a moment, what isomers we're making of the trimethylbenzene. You should consider this to be an icon, simply identifying trimethylbenzene, not a statement of the isomeric selectivity. Let me first consider the mechanism of the reaction. This is well-known chemistry in organometallics. It involves coordination of acetylene molecules to a metal center, perhaps formation of this metallocyclopentadiene intermediate, insertion of a third molecule of acetylene, and elimination now of the substituted benzene product and restoration of the methyl center here. So in principle, this can be done catalytically, and it can be done on a variety of methods. If we look at methyl acetylene, where we have a methyl group here and a hydrogen here, we can ask about the different isomeric products that we might expect to come out of this reaction. We have two options in terms of the trimethylbenzene, 1,2,4 and 1,3,5. If we simply assemble these randomly, we would expect the ratio of 1,2,4 to 1,3,5 to be 3:1. And in fact, we can demonstrate that that's the case on our titanium oxide surfaces by very careful calibration of the mass spectrometer fragmentation patterns. They are different for the 1,2,4 and the 1,3,5 isomers. These are the cracking patterns of authentic samples of those. Here's the 3:1 average of those, and here's the cracking pattern for the trimethylbenzene product of methyl acetylene trimerization on the KiO2 surface. And again, one has to go to the third decimal place to find a difference, and we think that we're making then the random distribution of these two isomers. What it says is that we're not doing stereospecific oligomerization, but it does say that if we ever manage to do it, we've got a fighting chance to detect that we've done it, and we're working on that. Let me go back to the surface site requirements for this reaction. That's kind of illustrated on this slide. This is showing you the yield of the different species desorbing from the surface. This is now on our highly reduced surfaces here, and here are the oxidized stoichiometric KiO2 surfaces. You can see that more than two-thirds of the carbon that goes on the surface as methyl acetylene comes off the surface as trimethylbenzene. So the selectivity of this reaction is really quite high. But the other interesting thing is that as we oxidize the surface from this most reduced state, the yield of the trimerization product first goes up, and then it falls off a cliff. And within a 50 degree range of the prior annealing temperature, we essentially go from all to nothing in terms of the production of the trimethylbenzene. So it's extraordinarily sensitive to the oxidation state of the surface. The reason for that is that we believe this reaction is occurring on a single kind of surface cation. We get a very good correlation between the yield of the trimerization product shown in this curve and the population of titanium cations in the +2 valence state. And you see both of those fall off a cliff over essentially the identical and very narrow temperature region. Titanium 1 goes away before that, titanium 3 goes away after that, and the average oxidation state, if you sum all of those up, also declines much more gradually as a function of our prior annealing temperature than does the titanium +2 population. So our conclusion about this reaction is that we're making, as I showed you, the random distribution of the isomers. The active site for doing this reaction are individual titanium plus two cations. Those are quenched over a very narrow range of annealing temperatures, and likewise the reaction is quenched. And again, we can draw a very nice analogy with organometallic chemistry in solution. Titanium two centers are known to at least dimerize acetylene to make these kinds of dicyclopentadiene ligands, from which one would make the trimer by insertion of a third acetylene. But the point is, if you start with titanium two, the formation of the cyclopentadiene, metallocyclopentadiene, is essentially a two-electron oxidation of the titanium center. So just as in solution, we have to have sites capable of going from plus two to plus four, of going through two valence states. And that also holds for other metal complexes in solution. Again, all of these mononuclear, showing you that individual cations in low valence states can do this chemistry. It's well known in solution, and I think our results show that you can do it on a surface as well. Let me begin to summarize. I think that what I've shown you so far demonstrates the kind of thing that we can get out of studies on oxide single crystals, and the connections that we can draw to the chemistry of transition metal complexes in solution. And I've shown you examples where we make the connections in terms of coordination environment to redox properties. In the case of these last two coupling reactions, either to the average oxidation state of the surface, in the case of the carbonyl coupling, or to the populations of cations in specific oxidation states, in the case of the alkyne trimerization. I think there are opportunities from that kind of understanding to turn the stoichiometric reactions that are known in solution and that we see on our surfaces into new catalysis. And I've shown you perhaps one possibility of that with the reductive coupling of the carbonyl compound. One thing that's troubled us as we've done this work, we're getting analogies with coordination chemistry in solution, homogeneous catalysis that usually is extremely selective, and where the catalyst is extremely uniform. The question is, we're also getting quite high selectivities on our surfaces. Are they that uniform? Can we expect to make surfaces, even in our model systems, even in single crystals, which are as uniform as the complex in solution? Especially if we're doing abusive things like bombarding them with argon ions to reduce them. Well, lately we've been doing scanning probe microscopies, STM and AFM, to try to address these questions, and I want to show you a few of the recent AFM results from our lab. The first is shown here. If someone can dim those lights, I think it might be a little more visible. This is the atomic force micrograph of light control of a titanium dioxide single crystal surface annealed to 750 Kelvin. And if you can see that, you may find it distressing. There are blotches here. Thank you. This doesn't look like a perfectly flat single crystal surface. If you look at the numbers, however, I think they're rather reassuring. We're looking at a region here which is 500 nanometers on a side, and what we're seeing are quite uniform in size plateaus and uniform in height, plateaus of perhaps 500 angstroms on the side on this surface. So these plateaus are about 100 unit cells on a side. Look here at the roughness of the surface. It's in the range of a few angstroms. So these spots correspond to very flat plateaus, 100 unit cells on a side by perhaps one unit cell high. And the false color here is showing you variations of approximately plus or minus one unit cell on the surface. We can calculate edge site distributions. We can calculate surface areas. The surface areas of these are about 1.2% above the nominal value for a perfect flat surface. So the message is that the number of defect sites, or the number of different kinds of sites than we find on these flat plateaus, has a population of perhaps a few percent. So our single crystals aren't perfect, but in spite of the false color image here, they really are describable to within 1 or 2% in terms of the structures of perfect single crystal surfaces. Again, the chemistry that I've shown you dominates the surface, yields of two-thirds of the adsorbed molecule. So it's clearly the chemistry on those flat planes that we're detecting in the experiments that I've run. Now you might ask what happens when we ion bombard this surface. That's illustrated here. The size of those plateaus shrinks a little bit. They get perhaps half as big, maybe a quarter as big, but the roughness changes very little. So in fact, our ion bombardment treatments are much more effective at reducing the surface, and I've shown you the dramatic effect of surface reduction, than they are at really roughening the surface and disrupting the structure. And so I think that's why, again, we can do some extraordinarily selective chemistry on what you might think would be a very heterogeneous surface. Now, while I'm showing pictures from the family album, I thought I would show one more. This is perhaps hard to see. This is the sputtered surface after we have exposed it to a few langers of benzoquinone in the ultra-high vacuum chamber and withdrawn it back into air to do the imaging. If you'll recall, we think this is making polyphenylene polymers on the surface. And at least I can see a difference between this image and the last one. There are halos now around each of the plateaus. I think the clearest one is perhaps here, and you can see another one there. And what we think is going on, and this is a very preliminary interpretation, is that at the edges of these plateaus, either where the polymer stops short or perhaps where it runs over the edge, we're seeing the mechanical difference in this mechanical imaging technique between the polymeric overlayer and the oxide surface underneath. Again, look at the scale. This is rather low resolution. We're certainly not seeing molecules, but it does suggest that we may be able to see the effects of reactants, sorbates, products that we've made in ultra-high vacuum in these scanning probe microscopies, even at low resolution, and maybe we'll be able to see molecules at higher resolution. So let me skip this. It essentially describes those AFM images I've shown you, and let me finish now on a philosophical note. I think 10 years ago we would have regarded the statements on this slide not as myths, but as truisms. Conventional wisdom not so long ago was that our arsenal of surface science techniques was very powerful, but we were restricted in its application to metals. I think the work I've shown you this morning and the work that others have done in the last decade have clearly shown that these can be applied to oxides and to other non-metallic materials, and that there's a great deal to be learned from doing that. The second point is one I think is coming along more slowly. Suppose that surface scientists are the inquisitive children of catalysis. We're very good at taking things apart, but we rarely put them back together. We're good at decomposing molecules, and there are good thermodynamic reasons that that's the case in ultra-high vacuum, but not very often are we able to synthesize interesting things, especially when that synthesis involves the formation of carbon-carbon bonds, the formation of products with higher molecular weights than those with which we began. Well, I've shown you some examples from our list where we can actually do some very interesting syntheses, some carbon-carbon bond assembly in ultra-high vacuum, and others, I think, are demonstrating some equally dramatic examples on metals and on. The last of these, I'm afraid, we have not yet relegated to the realm of myth. We have yet to demonstrate that we can take a reaction discovered on a single crystal in ultra-high vacuum and turn it into a new catalytic process. It's something that's certainly a goal of my group. Probably half of the group is now pursuing this end, and I hope some of you in the audience will decide to take up that challenge as well. The fact that we're in a position to make that attempt at all is really due to the people who've done the very hard work over the years, and this is a list of the students and postdocs and some industrial collaborators that I've had the pleasure of working with. I think at least half of them on that list have made some direct contribution to the data that you've seen this morning. The other point, of course, is that except for the lower right corner here, all of these people have needed to be housed and clothed and fed, and that would not have been possible without the continuing support of the National Science Foundation, the Department of Energy, and sponsors of the Center for Catalytic Science and Technology at the University of Delaware. And I certainly am very grateful to them. I'm grateful to the Catalysis Society for this recognition, and I thank you as well for the opportunity to share this work with you this morning.
Here in front of the audience, and there he is.